Welcome to Inflammation Nation. My name is Brian Lynch. Inflammation Nation is a podcast from Arthritis Ireland aimed at increasing awareness and understanding of arthritis and related conditions. I'm delighted to be joined today by Sinéad Moriarty and Sean Lacey, who are here to talk about their experiences of being newly diagnosed with arthritis. Sinéad is a best-selling author of 16 novels, including her two most recent titles, About Us and The New Girl, a book aimed at younger readers. Sinéad was diagnosed with rheumatoid arthritis in 2015 and shared her experiences of that in a book published by Arthritis Ireland called My RA Story. Sean works as an IT contractor, he's married to Avril and dad to two young girls. A self-declared fitness enthusiast, he says, he was diagnosed with psoriatic arthritis in June 2020 at the height of the first phase of the COVID-19 pandemic. You're both very welcome. Thank you for joining us today for this episode of Inflammation Nation. Sinéad, I wonder, can we start with you? Do you mind bringing us back to where you were and what was going on when you first became unwell?
So back to 2015, my parents were on holidays in Spain and I got a call to say that my dad had had a heart attack and wasn't well. So I flew over and then he subsequently had another heart attack and died, right? So then we were trying to get the body home and it was bank holiday weekend and the whole thing was a bit of a nightmare. And when throughout the whole process, I noticed that my knee had flared up. And I just thought I must have, you know, twisted it while I was running around trying to organise everything. Anyway, obviously pretty distracted with the funeral and everything and let it go for a while, but I couldn't get it to heal. So I went to physio and then eventually they did exploratory surgery. And the surgeon said, look, you know, there's quite a bit of inflammation there. Maybe you should see a rheumatologist. So I thought, fine, kind of forgot about it. And the usual, you know, waiting for 3 months to see a rheumatologist. But I started feeling really unwell and I thought maybe I was getting early menopause or something. My eyes were really dry and gritty. I was exhausted. Like I'd have 10 hours sleep and I'd wake up feeling as if I hadn't closed my eyes. Mm-hmm. I was freezing all the time, absolutely freezing, couldn't get warm. But then I'd wake up at night drenched in sweat, all these kind of crazy symptoms, which all could be menopausal. So I just thought, oh, that's what it is. Eventually, I did get to see a rheumatologist and I was admitted to hospital straight away because I was really very unwell at that point. I had a very, very severe flare-up and I'd never heard of, you know, inflammatory markers or anything. I'd never heard of rheumatoid arthritis. I didn't even know what it was. And when they eventually told me what it was, I had to Google it and then it just said, you know, autoimmune condition where your body attacks itself, there is no cure. And all I could remember is there is no cure. And I thought, oh Christ, am I going to feel like this forever? Because I couldn't even lift up my mobile phone. Like I was in absolute tatters. But then, you know, the first year was very difficult because they couldn't get it under control. And I was on, you know, double doses of everything, steroids, injections, methotrexate. I was having my knees drained and injected with steroids every single week. And eventually, after a year, I went into Vincent's and went into the nuclear department and had radiation injected directly into my knees. And that finally got it under control. So I'm not going to lie, the first year was an absolute nightmare and I was just beside myself. I just thought, is this it? I've got three young kids. Am I not going to be able to walk again? Like, what kind of quality of life am I going to have? And the steroids, as anybody who has been on high doses of steroids know, are a nightmare because you can't sleep and you're constantly irritated. And, or irritable, sorry, is the correct word. So the good news is after I had the synovectomy, which is where they inject radiation into your joint, I got my life back. It got it under control. And I've slowly been able to come off steroids. I came off methotrexate and now I just inject myself once every 3 weeks. And I have my life back and I have my sense of humor back and life is good. So that's the message. The first year was really difficult. Second year less so, and it's become less so since. But like it's 5 years now, and you know, certainly I completely back to myself now.
Mm. In fact, listening to you there, I mean, what strikes me is actually how traumatizing that first year was. You know, that these were traumatic things that were happening with your body and the effect on you as a person trying to figure out what was going on, the uncertainty, the doubts that were there. And like you mentioned, even reading that line, there is no cure. Mm. Like that's a kind of, that can be pretty grim to see that and think, oh my God, this is me.
Yeah, I mean, I ended up going to see a counsellor because I was really struggling to kind of accept and understand what was going on. And she said, you know, you've got post-traumatic stress, which I thought was kind of embarrassing because it's not like I could just come back from Iraq. But she said, no, no, you know, this is a sudden trauma and you're just trying to process it. And that's why you're struggling so much. So I did find that helpful. I went three times, but I did find it very helpful. So something I would recommend if you're struggling, because it's very lonely. And I remember when I worked with you guys on the book of firsthand accounts of people with rheumatoid arthritis, when we had that book launch, like, it is like finding your tribe, because people, like anything, people don't understand what it's like to be in a situation unless they have it. And so it was lovely to talk to other people. And when I was first diagnosed, you know, I spoke, lots of people were very kind and gave me their time and spoke to me. And I've subsequently tried to pay that forward, you know, by talking to people who've just been diagnosed or are struggling. So, you know, I think it's really important that we talk about it and raise awareness, because it was so lonely. And I was in hospital Googling. And then I just found this one little article about a woman who's the same age as me. It happened very suddenly. She'd always been very healthy all her life. And I just found it so reassuring, because she said, look, the first year is awful, but you will be okay. Mm. And that's what that's the message I'm trying to get out, is that, you know, even if you are struggling, it's going to get better.
Mm-hmm. Great, thank you. Sean, I wonder if we can turn to yourself. What was your experience like? Obviously, you were kind of much newer to it in terms of early last year getting the diagnosis. Can you talk to us about what was happening for you and what your experience has been like?
Yes, Brian. It was around, the start of COVID, when we were all told we worked from home. And shortly into that, then I started getting severe, inflammation on my fingers and toes. I previously got a little bit the year before, but it kind of died down quickly and I didn't kind of pay too much attention to it at the time. So started swelling up, and then after a couple of weeks, nothing was happening. So I got a phone call with GP, talked it through, and I kind of had done a little bit of research myself and suspected psoriatic arthritis might be the reason behind it.
Mm. So why did you think that?
Just from pictures and the inflammation of the fingers and toes was very, very like the dactylitis. Mm. And I kind of knew it wasn't kind of an infection, because it kind of was different fingers and toes and kind of was moving around. Some were worse than others some days. So kind of self-diagnosed that, spoke to the GP, and they said they felt it was reactive arthritis, not psoriatic. Mm. Because it didn't have any psoriasis.
Yes, okay, yeah.
So subsequently, I think a week later, I went through my healthcare or my health insurance provider and did a phone consultation with a different GP, and he immediately asked for a video call, so he asked for video of my fingers and toes and said, yeah, psoriatic arthritis, definitely. So,
because that's interesting, because it's one of the challenges of PSA is the difficulty of diagnosing, because the blood tests are kind of different from rheumatoid, for example, and not having psoriasis in itself. Would have been kind of a challenge, I suppose, in unraveling all of that.
Yeah, I guess thinking back, I have had a little bit of scalp psoriasis kind of all through my life, but nothing that's ever needed medication or anything. So I never even considered I had psoriasis.
Yeah.
But I guess speaking to the rheumatologist first time, he went, yeah, that's kind of normal enough that you just have a little bit of mild. But first time talking to the GP, I didn't even consider I had psoriasis, because I'd never kind of been to a doctor for it or kind of taken any medication. So I guess didn't really think I had it.
Mm.
Yeah, but I guess I was lucky enough with the dactylitis and a little bit of psoriasis, it was easy enough to diagnose. I think if you don't have the dactylitis, it can be a lot more difficult to diagnose. So I was lucky in that regard, and saw the rheumatologist, immediately confirmed the GP's diagnosis, and immediately just kind of put me on steroids to take down the fingers and toes, and that worked. And then back with him later in the year, and kind of had come back a little bit again, so he put me on methotrexate, and I've been on that since.
Mm. Mm. And what was your own reaction kind of when your suspicions were confirmed, you know, when you hear, yeah, this is what it is, you've got this psoriatic arthritis, this incurable condition again, like Sinéad?
Immediately, like Sinéad, went Googling everything and to see what is this all about, because I'd never heard of it.
Yeah.
Thought arthritis is something old people get, this wasn't going to be. And yeah, the more I looked into it, I'd even seen signs through my life of other possible symptoms. So it could have been something that was lingering with me for a long time, but just never really came to the force. Even looking back at different things, I've had kind of ongoing lower back, left hand side issues for years. And that's since been diagnosed as probably sacroiliitis, which is very common in psoriatic arthritis as well. So even kind of looking back, kind of when I used to play football and stuff, I always used to get probably sore than most people after it. And kind of just me, but maybe it was a little bit at the time. And without always having like psoriasis since I was basically a teenager, probably there's been a little bit there the whole time. It just kind of just came to the fore. probably the stress of COVID maybe has brought it out last year is what I'm thinking. Just brought to the fore and...
Yeah, of course, yeah.
Because they say, like, if you will get a bad flare-up during a stressful situation. So there was none really else stressful around that time last year, so it must have been kind of that. So, yeah, kind of managing it since then, pretty much under control. I've had two major flare-ups this year, one after the first COVID vaccine, and the second one was the really hot week we had weather-wise in the summer.
Oh, yeah, in mid-July, yes.
played havoc with me.
Right, okay.
Yeah, so since then, it's pretty much under control. Still only on the methotrexate. Take steroids the odd time as needed, but thankfully not too often. Tried an anti-inflammatory recently, just and cause I did notice since the COVID vaccine, I've developed a lot of enthesitis, pretty much in my knees and elbows and a little bit in my hip. So that's kind of, that inflammatory work kind of brought that down a bit. So plan is go back to the GP or the rheumatologist in February and kind of maybe discuss moving to a biologic then, just depending on what condition it is. But yeah, it's pretty much under control at the moment. So that's good.
Good to hear. Yeah. I wonder in terms of both of you, like your parents, you know, so you're kind of, your disease just doesn't affect you as an individual on your own. It affects your spouses, your parents, the rest of your family. How did they experience that, or how did it kind of impact on you being a mom or being a dad? Sinéad, do you want to kick off there?
Well, I suppose I tried to kind of hide it from them as much as possible because, I mean, this all happened 5 years ago and they were much younger. They just thought, you know, I had a sore knee. We kind of didn't really get into it. But, you know, I wasn't myself. I mean, I wasn't, you know, I'm always on the go, like running around like a lunatic, doing 10 million different things. And I just had to slow down and pare back. And I just wasn't myself, you know. And that's actually why I went to see the counsellor, because I was kind of really struggling, you know, to kind of find my energy, my humour, just myself again. And I, you know, I really wanted them, you know, to have me back, you know. So I do think it's important, you know, that if you are struggling to reach out for help. And interesting, just what Sean was saying about methotrexate, I found methotrexate very difficult on my stomach. I felt nauseous all the time, like it's strong, you know, the high doses.
Agree.
Yeah, it's tough. Like since I've been able to come off it and just be on the biologicals, it's brilliant. I have no side effects. So yeah, it's tough, isn't it?
Yeah, methotrexate, I was initially fine on it. Then I guess after the first flare up, it seemed to affect me more. Now I've kind of got under control again. Like I've kind of learned what time of day to take it.
Yeah.
Have a big meal beforehand. I found coconut water, the electrolytes in that seem to help with the nausea. So I managed to get through it now. I can sometimes have problems sleeping the night after taking it. But generally, compared to what it was, yeah, I have it under control. But yeah, it's not a nice drug and I would love to get off it as well.
Yeah. The other thing is, which the pharmacist told me, was to take 2 a.m, 2 p.m, 2 p.m. I was just taking all 6 in the morning and then I just feel nauseous for 3 days. So actually all those little things do help. But they're things you wouldn't necessarily know. You kind of, you know, they're all little sort of,
you have to kind of nearly
of
go
trade.
Through it. Yes. Yeah. Yeah.
Kind
it's
of,
the
yeah.
Experience. Yeah,
yeah. Yeah. But I mean, biologicals have been a life changer. And you know, there's so much research at the moment into like rheumatoid and all the different types of arthritis. Like I am hopeful that they'll find a natural solution eventually, because I do think certainly in Scandinavia, they seem to be quite close. So I do have hope that we'll be able to come off these. Because I'm someone who never even wanted to take an Anitin. Like, I hate taking drugs. But they are necessary evil and they work. And I get that, you know. But yeah, so to come back to your question, sorry, and Sean can talk about his experience. Yeah, I was really upset because I felt it was affecting the kids. So that's why I sought help.
And do you want to talk a bit in terms of how it affected them? Was it kind of things that you were used to be able to do with them then that?
Yeah,
kind of
it was stuff like
anymore?
I wasn't as mobile because, you know, like I got my sort of elbows and wrists under control, but I just couldn't get my knees under control. So walking was tricky. I was able to drive because my left knee was really bad, and I drive an automatic car, but just not being myself and, you know, just, I suppose, not being able to do all the things I could do. And, you know, I suppose I was living in my head a bit as well because I was trying to figure it all out. So, yeah, you know, I just wanted to be back to the fun mom, you know, not just sort of miserable mom. So anyway, thankfully, things have got better.
Yeah. Great.
So
good to hear that. Yeah, Sean, what you've two young girls, I think, isn't
it? Yeah, two young girls. They're 11 and 9. So yeah, I haven't really hidden it from them, but I guess they probably, don't understand, the full diagnosis of it and what it kind of means long term. But yeah, like Sinead, it's just not having the energy and time for them that you'd like to have. Mm. Like I did kind of notice this year during the summer, or previous years I would have been out playing tennis or volleyball or badminton in the back garden with them. This year I just probably didn't have the energy to do as much with them. Like try to go out, but sometimes you just, it's hard, you just don't have the energy to kind of go out and do what you want. And I would say definitely, because I'm working full time, definitely resting more weekends. And it would have been like, Sinead, go, and weekends were go, do things. And But now it's very much kind of need to rest a little bit of weekends, so I'm kind of ready for the next week.
Mm. It's interesting to hear you mention energy there. I think that possibly is one of the symptoms of arthritis that people don't expect, really. You know, we oftentimes think, you know, God, I'm tired, or kind of ambitious. We all suffer fatigue or exhaustion. Yeah. But it's a very different caliber, isn't it, when you kind of are living with inflammatory arthritis?
It's actually, when I get tired, I just get really overwhelmed now. I need sleep so badly. I think rest is so important, and you actually have to, you have to get it. You know, I remember somebody saying to me, maybe it was a rheumatologist or somebody that I saw, said, look, on your best day, you're now operating at 80%. And on your worst day, well, let's not even go there. But, you know, and I do find, like, if I like have a couple of nights really bad sleep or whatever, bloody menopause now has been thrown into the middle of it. But anyway, I get really overwhelmed really easily. So rest, you know, I just found that it's so important. You really, you know, you have to look after yourself that little bit more. And it's a pain because you don't have the energy levels you used to. But, you know, I mean, at 80%, I think, you know, I'm doing well, so that's fine. But yeah, no, rest is so important. Like, you really do need it.
Mm-hmm. And of course, that involves a certain reprioritizing in many cases, doesn't it? Like, you know, that you are making those decisions to put yourself first to be able to do that and kind of go from there. I'm wondering, in terms of, Sean, you mentioned career there. So you work in the IT industry as a contractor.
Yeah.
And obviously, your kind of period coming to terms with psoriatic arthritis has coincided with COVID. So you've been, you still working from home? Are you back in the office? What has that work environment been like for you?
Yeah, pretty much still working from home. I ventured into the office 2 weeks ago for the first time just to meet my boss and a few of the others, but pretty much have been home since March last year.
Mm.
So yeah, so during it then I switched to being an IT contractor halfway through COVID, which was made redundant from my job, and then just switched to contracting as just a way to kind of keep working during COVID and kind of get back to, I had kind of gone into a managerial type role, so back to, the core IT that I used to love before, so I'm back doing that now. So yeah, it's been challenging, definitely, trying to do that during COVID. I guess it's probably helped with the diagnosis in that I don't have the fatigue of travelling in and out of the office that I would have if it was normal time, so I guess that could have been different.
Mm.
But yeah, I guess I haven't been around an office too much, so I guess nobody's really noticed.
Yeah,
what's kind of, I guess, anything different about me. I guess the people I'm working with now don't know me anyway. So
yes, yeah.
I've only met two of them. So
yeah, it's kind of the bizarre thing, isn't it? What COVID has changed so much. Anyone who has changed role or changed jobs, like, you know, the kind of the sense in which you know someone, and particularly, you know, something as significant as living with a chronic condition, and how you bring that to your line manager or to your colleagues, like, you know, and explain what's going on there.
Yeah, I haven't had to do that yet, so that will be an interesting conversation, whatever happens. And I guess as a contractor, I work for myself, so I guess there's probably no real onus on me to even say anything. It's I guess if in a full-time job it might be different, and I guess more challenging, but I guess once I can do my work, and I work for myself essentially, so
And do you think, like, in terms of, say, you know, obviously the economy is reopening, people are going back into work, and you're now possibly in a more vulnerable position, shall we say, in terms of, you know, someone living with autoimmune and the risks that are, you know, potentially facing you in the environment. Is that something you're more conscious of now than you were maybe 2 years ago? Well, there was no pandemic, of course, 2 years ago.
Yeah, and I guess 2 years ago I didn't have autoimmune either. Yeah, so, yeah. I'm very much new to all this. Yeah, it would scare me going back into an office full time, but and probably not even so much being in the office, is the travelling in and out on public transport to the office for, I guess, you're on crowded buses and crowded Lewis's, and I guess that's probably more than actually the office itself. I felt safe and fine in there. It's the going in and out of the office I found a lot more stressful.
Yeah, sure. I can imagine. Sinéad, what about you? How did it affect, you know, your work as a writer?
Yeah, well, just interesting just to when Sean was talking about stress, like stress is such a trigger, but then when you get it, you're stressed because you don't know what it is. So it's a slightly vicious circle as well. Mm-hmm. Well, obviously, like as a writer, I work from home, so I don't have any stressful commute or anything. But I was, when COVID first came out, I was terrified I was going to get it because I was really worried about how it was going to affect somebody with, you know, autoimmune problems. So I was really worried, but actually I got a vaccine quite early, which was great, from my GP. But in terms of work, I wrote a book called The Good Mother the first year I was diagnosed, and I actually think it's the best book I've ever written. And I think it's because I was just living inside my head, and one of the characters in the book completely subconsciously ends up in hospital and spends a lot of time in there. And I think I was just getting a lot out when I wrote it. And actually, you know, it's like everything, you know, whenever something happens, my editor always goes, oh, well, you can always use it. And I think I used sort of the fear and what I was going through and put it into the character in the book. And the book worked out really well. So I think I'm lucky in that I'm able to, in a way, kind of process things through writing. And that really helps. And in fact, when I was writing, it was the only time that I wasn't worrying about, you know, the future, what kind of effect this is going to have on me, my kids, whatever. Was I going to end up in a wheelchair? I didn't know what was going to happen. So writing for me was kind of my meditation and my happy place. So that's, I'm very lucky in that, you know, what I do was where I was able to go. I was able to disappear into my work.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's kind of
it. Yeah.
Yeah, really insightful to be able to hear. Yeah, and even the point you're making there about concerns for the future, that's something we're going to come back and explore a little further on. We're going to take a short break from our conversation with Sinéad and Sean just for a few moments to take a regular look at popular beliefs about arthritis. This week, Peter Boyd is exploring whether arthritis is just an older person's condition or whether children who are living with juvenile arthritis can grow out of it.
Thanks a million for that, Brian. Today we're going to examine the belief that arthritis is an older person's condition. While age is certainly a risk factor for some forms of arthritis, there are well over 1,000 children living with juvenile arthritis in Ireland, and thousands more adults of all ages living with some form of arthritis. Is that understood across the board, or does it take a family diagnosis to bring that appreciation to the public? Arthritis is an equal opportunities employer, meaning anyone from the youngest child to the eldest centurion can be diagnosed with arthritis. We asked Niamh Hogan to travel to Portlaoise to gauge the levels of understanding that exists among the public about arthritis and age.
No, my cousin has had arthritis since she was very young, so I know it's not an old person's disease.
Rheumatoid arthritis in my sister-in-law actually has the arthritis in her 30s.
Younger people suffer from arthritis, yes, without doubt. Now, personally myself, thank God I don't. No, a lot of younger people do get it, and I wish they didn't. I'm glad I'm not one of them.
I know young people can get it as well. I've often heard of young people getting it, as my mother, she's older. She has it now as well, so she does.
Well, anybody who sustains injury when they're younger, regardless of age, they can get arthritis, I believe, and I know of numerous cases in their 40s because, you know, it makes them more susceptible to arthritis, any breakage. And I know of numerous cases playing hurling or football or even car accidents or anything, you know.
Yeah, I think it's for everybody. I think it affects older people more, but young people can definitely get it.
Oh, everyone can get it, like from the young age, you know, yeah. It's for old people.
I would believe it to be an older person's disease, as I've only heard of older people, never anyone young getting it.
So thanks very much to Niamh Hogan for those views on the streets there. We've had some quite conflicting views, a little bit of understanding, but not quite getting the whole picture of arthritis for the young right the way through to the very elderly. I'm joined now by Dr. Emma MacDermott. Emma, you're very welcome to Inflammation Nation. Is this the same view that you have, that anyone across all ages can get arthritis?
Absolutely. And thank you very much, Peter, for having me today. I work in paediatrics, so I absolutely am aware of the fact that arthritis can strike at any age. And my entire population is children and young people under the age of 18. So we have a population that ranges from toddlers all the way through to patients that were transitioning into the adult services. So absolutely, while it is not seen frequently, and there are many people who are unaware of children who are affected, this is a condition that can affect and does affect many young people and children in Ireland, and has a massive impact on their own lives and the lives of their families.
And we heard from the Vox Pops there, people were kind of surprised or didn't know that younger people could get arthritis. Does it come as I suppose it's a real shock to parents and their families that arthritis could even be mentioned for younger people?
It does.
Children?
In fact, it comes as a shock that there are such things as paediatric rheumatologists. I often meet when I say to people, oh, I'm a paediatric rheumatologist. Oh, I didn't realize children could get that. So for families and parents, obviously, when they come to us, they know they're coming to a rheumatologist. They're coming because their children have joint pains. I think that the shocking thing for them is often that we're talking about a chronic inflammatory condition that is impacting their children now and can have long-term consequences and can be a lifelong condition for these children. So I think there's quite a lot of myths and legends probably around arthritis in children. And the biggest one that we confront is, oh, well, they'll grow out of it. And as you well know, Peter, there are many forms of arthritis. There are short-term types of arthritis, such as inflammation that you get around a joint when you have an infection, or as a result of an infectious process that then settles down over time, or arthritis around or inflammation around a joint that has been injured. All of those things do happen in children, and all of them are things that probably won't last into adulthood. So that is possibly where that myth comes from. But when a child has an inflammatory arthritis, much like in an adult, it is a chronic condition that is a diagnosis for life. Thankfully, these days, we have lots of very good therapies. We have lots of excellent support mechanisms for children and young people and adults with arthritis. So we anticipate and we encourage families to fully pursue their lives, their activities, and we support them as best we can in doing that. But yes, it's a chronic diagnosis, and parents are often very taken aback by that.
And is it something that, when you look at your remit as a paediatric rheumatologist, is it something that you have to look at with the families as well as the child or the teenager that's in your care to look at maybe a whole family to be treated and to be looked after?
Absolutely. Our practices in paediatrics is always to look after a family and to try and take into account all of the aspects that are affected by having a child with a chronic illness, be that parents needing to take off time from work to care for the child, or indeed to travel for appointments, the impact on siblings, the education around the classroom, around sporting activities, education of teachers, of coaches, ensuring that these children are integrated into all of the activities that they want to be integrated into, but that people are aware of the limitations and of the things to look out for in a child who has GIA. So usually, when a child is diagnosed with juvenile arthritis, our multidisciplinary team does try to provide support and individualize that for patients with respect to what they need.
Well, hopefully that all the children in your care, and they do get as much support as possible, their families and all that support network around them. And thank you for clearing that up and explaining to us all about how children, teenagers, and all the way up to the elder centurions get arthritis. And we really appreciate you joining us, Dr. Emma MacDermott, paediatric rheumatologist. Thanks for joining us on Inflammation Nation.
Thanks Peter, and thank you all.
And now we hand back to Brian Lynch in further conversation with Sinéad Moriarty.
Guys, I'm wondering, in terms of the impact on your life, and you've touched on some of these elements already with regard to kind of being fatigued, how have you found kind of your arthritis has affected things like your normal everyday lives, being the capacity to be physically active, your social life. Have you had to do much reorienting and reorganizing of those aspects of who you are?
In the beginning, yes, because mobility sometimes was a problem depending on how bad my knees were. As regard, yeah, I mean, I think I suppose I now prioritize differently. Do you know what I mean? And if I have like, say, a couple of work events in 1 week, or, you know, nights out or whatever, I'll be really careful to rest before, you know, if something's coming up, or Christmas or whatever, if there's a really busy time coming up, I'll try and get extra rest beforehand, because otherwise I just will struggle. Yeah, definitely. I am more conscious of that. And I suppose just kind of reconfiguring things. Yeah. I always try and make sure that I'm going to have gaps in between events, just so that I can kind of just recoup. Mm. Yeah, I think so. Yeah.
Mm. I guess I haven't really had the social problem yet because of COVID.
Yeah, that's true.
I haven't been out and about, I guess. But yeah, it has made me nervous, certainly, about going back and meeting people. And probably, given the current numbers and stuff like that, I'm not in a hurry to. I've met my close friends and stuff like that. But yeah, kind of wider, no, I'm not in too much of a hurry. So it definitely has had an impact in, I guess, I'm still waiting for my third booster vaccine. So I guess until I get that, I'm probably trying to keep definitely a low profile at the moment.
Mm. And you were saying previously to me, you know, that you kind of do an awful lot of fitness and training and stuff. So, like, have you had to kind of pull back from some of that, or kind of look differently at how you stay fit and healthy?
Yeah, I do CrossFit, which I guess is a mixture of, for people that know, a mixture of weightlifting, gymnastics, and kind of just aerobic fitness. But yeah, I'm still trying to find a balance between doing too much and causing a mini flare-up versus kind of doing enough to... I find it really helps the arthritis and the joints if I can get the balance right. But yeah, I have been guilty lately of sometimes pushing myself too hard and it having a negative effect on me. So yeah, I'm definitely determined to keep up and just kind of maintain, I guess, the balance between doing too much and not doing enough. But yeah, the place I'm in have been great. They have, I guess, they call it a return to play option on the workout. So it's, if you're injured or you're not feeling good that day, you can do a more scaled back version of the workout, which I guess a lot of times I will look at and go, yeah, that's probably for me today. But yeah, there's times I feel great and I'll go do the full workout and feel great afterwards. But yeah, it's finding the balance.
Yeah, and it sounds like self-awareness then is really important in, you know, whatever aspect you're trying to kind of figure out what's right for you now.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. I'm curious in terms of, you know, when you started telling your friends and your kind of wider circle, what their reactions were, you know, because that sense, oftentimes, I mean, obviously, we kind of, both of you, you know, you're kind of, you're in your younger years, but there is a popular perception oftentimes that arthritis is just something that only affects older people. Did you get the "you're too young to have arthritis" response?
Initially, it was like, oh, is that the, you know, oh yeah, like loads of people get that. People didn't know what rheumatoid arthritis was. There is a lack of awareness about it. And then I got a lot of, you know, you should take turmeric because that'll heal it. I was going, that's a little more serious than that. But if turmeric was able to solve it, wouldn't that be grand? But yeah, or, oh, my mum, my dad has that. I'm kind of going, no, she has osteo, you know, it's different. But, you know, that's, I totally get that because I'd never heard of it. So yeah. I don't really have a problem with that at all. But that's why I think it's important to raise awareness about it. And rheumatoid does affect more women than men. But interestingly, the nurse I go to for my blood tests, her little girl has it and she's only three. And I think that's really, really hard. You know, I think juvenile rheumatoid must be just awful for kids. But thankfully, most of them grow out of it, which is the good news. And then there was a lot of, where did you get that from? You know, nobody in our family has it. Nobody on the other side of the family has it. I'm going, well, actually, I think it's just bad luck. So, yeah, there was a bit of that as well. But yeah, like I totally get that because I was ignorant of it myself. So I don't know about Sean.
Yeah, I'd say, I guess, barring my wife, I guess that I really talked to, probably I would say understands fully, I guess, the ramifications of having it. I guess they probably just hear arthritis and go, yeah, if you're sore joints, they don't understand, I guess, the fatigue side of it or the inflammatory side, because pretty much they're hidden diseases. So you appear fine on the outside.
Yeah.
And then you have literally people coming and kind of going, yeah, you look fine. There can't be too much wrong with you. And you're kind of going, well, actually, no, I'm hurting inside. So it can be challenging, yeah. But I guess start meeting friends again and having, I guess, a deeper conversation with them, it'll be easier to explain, I guess, the way it kind of is impacting more than what's on the outside.
That's actually a really good point, you know, because you do look fine on the outside. Yeah. But I remember trying to describe it to someone. I was saying, it's like somebody pours petrol on your joints and sets them on fire, because that's what a really bad flare-up feels like. I remember one day I couldn't get out of bed. I was going, thank God, like, my husband was there, because if I lived on my own, I wouldn't have made it to the bathroom. Like, it's things like that. Like, really, the nitty gritty of it in a really bad flare-up is quite scary. Thankfully, I've had very few of them. But just it gets down to that level. That's the amount of pain and lack of mobility that you can have during a really bad flare-up. Yeah. And thankfully, they're few and far between. But, you know, that's what it's like, and it's kind of hard to explain that.
Yeah. I know previously we had a couple of sets of what we called arthritis gloves, and they were compression gloves that had kind of like little pins and needles inside them.
Yeah.
And if you put them on, you know, for someone without arthritis, it gave you just the kind of slight sensation of that complications around mobility, the tingling that's constantly there, the lack of control over your fingers, you know. And we used to bring them to public events like the ploughing championships.
All right.
And it was really interesting to see people's reactions to them. I get a sense, oh my God, like, you know, imagine trying to do simple things like this, you know, and that's just such a minimal kind of experience of the thing. Petrol on fire over your joints, Sinéad, that's a kind of a fairly powerful way to describe it.
Well, it is, because I remember having a really bad flare, and even the weight of a sheet on my knees was like somebody was slamming bricks onto them.
Yeah.
Like, during a really bad flare-up, that's what it feels like.
Yeah.
You know, and your whole immune system is rampaging. And it's thank God for steroids. I mean, they are medical heroin, because, you know, within a couple of hours, you can be up and walking about. So, you know, although I hated taking them, they were a necessary evil. And, you know, I was on them for a long time, but I'm off them now, thank God. But no, they are brilliant and they work. But anyway, sorry, I don't mean to frighten anybody. That's only a really, really bad flare-up, and they are rare. But I suppose that's just the best way I could describe what it's like.
Yes,
when it's bad.
And of course, one of the challenges of, you know, both of your conditions is that enormous variability that exists in symptoms.
Yes.
You know, they are different from one person to the next. And, you know, I know, Sinéad, I've read you writing before about kind of hearing other people's experiences and that kind of that community, your tribe, that idea that you referred to earlier on. But of course, not everyone's experience, like you say, will be the same as what yours will be. So that can be both positive and negative to a certain extent.
Well, actually, you know, as I say, when you meet somebody who has the same condition, it is just lovely just to have that chat. But as you say, every single person I met and every single person I've spoken to, and there's been a lot over the years, has had a different experience. You know, some worse, for sure, and some, you know, less. But, you know, so as you say, everyone experiences it differently, and everyone reacts to the drugs differently, you know. Sometimes people have bad reactions to the drugs. I was lucky in that I didn't, so that was certainly a positive. So, you know, it's very hard to compare and contrast, because, and also there's so many different variants of it, you know what I mean? You can have rheumatoid, but you can also have so many other things as well.
Yes,
that go along with it. So, you know, I mean, I'll take what I have. You know, I really will.
Yeah. I'm wondering, guys, in terms of, you know, supports and resources that are available that helped you through kind of those early days when you were navigating either the health systems or, you know, kind of health information generally, were there particular things that you found were particularly useful? Sean, do you have anything that kind of, because you're so much newer, I suppose, in terms of your diagnosis, what do you find has helped you particularly?
My rheumatologist was very good. I was lucky enough during lockdown, I got actually a physical appointment to see him in May last year. He was actually, he never fully closed, which was great, because I know most consultants did close down. So that was great. He's been really good and kind of helped me through information and everything. I find, online communities, the Arthritis Ireland group on Facebook is very good, very informed, and there's people always willing to help. There's another one in the UK that's dedicated to psoriatic arthritis. And I've actually never yet actually talked to somebody else with my condition. Even though I did the Arthritis Ireland online course.
Self-management course.
Yeah, and nobody on that had psoriatic arthritis. I was hoping at least meet one other person, but no. But we had to actually have a chat with somebody else that's diagnosed with this.
Yeah. Well, actually, do you know what? It's an interesting thing, and it's a challenge we constantly have in terms of, okay, fewer men have inflammatory arthritis, with some of the conditions at least. But oftentimes men are so much more reluctant maybe to come out and share their experiences, to get involved, to support one another. So, like, it's a kind of, there's a challenge there around that, isn't there?
Definitely, even looking at the online Facebook groups, it is predominantly women.
Mm.
There's a few men, but I'd say it's 75-25.
Yeah.
I don't know whether it's men are not as easy to talk about things or whatever, but it definitely seems to be more support out there given by women than men.
Yeah, yeah. I suppose, when you think about it, you know what, for maybe a slightly older age cohort, I mean, this is what has led to kind of the foundation of the men's sheds movement, you know, precisely to get men to kind of be able to stand shoulder to shoulder and talk to one another about these kind of challenges. And you mentioned there, you know, kind of the support your rheumatologist has provided you and being able to access that service. Have you been able to tap into other members of the multidisciplinary team? Like, have you needed physiotherapy or occupational therapy?
I haven't yet, services? Thankfully. He actually has a rheumatology nurse as well, which I think the first private consultant in Ireland to have a dedicated rheumatology nurse, which is great. So
Wow. It's
somebody, if you can't contact him, we can just pick up the phone and ring her. His secretary is very good. If you send her an email, she'll be back to you either that day or the next day, whenever she's in the office. So yeah, they've been very welcoming and I guess open and very easy to communicate with. Because now that does tend to be a problem, is getting communication from your consultant. But yeah, it's been great.
Yeah. What about you, Sinéad, in terms of things that you found supports and resources that helped you particularly?
Well, I think, you know, just I think it's great that Sean, you know, has a good relationship. My first rheumatologist was awful. So then I moved and I got a lovely rheumatologist who I've stuck with. But that's really important as well, is to find the right sort of team around you. Like, so I finally found, you know, a rheumatologist I really like and who I also, you know, value his opinion and respect his opinion. And I went to see a nutritionist because for the first 2 years I was very strict on what I ate. Now I kind of eat everything because, you know, I've got it under control. I found that really helpful. And, you know, Arthritis Ireland, obviously the website is brilliant because that's where I learned about rheumatoid arthritis. And then communities, yeah, for me it was more word of mouth. Like, a lot of people would kind of go, oh, my cousin has that, or my mother-in-law or so and so, and then they would put me in touch with somebody else. So I had like probably 100 coffees, you know, because I'm all about information. I kept thinking, you know, if I get more information, I'll be able to fix this. And in fact, really, it just had to run its course and I just had to, you know, figure it out with rheumatologists and that. But I did find it kind of reassuring talking to people because it is lonely, because, you know, especially in the beginning, because you don't understand what it is and you're trying to figure it all out. But I would say, you know, really helpful thing is just to I spent far too much time trying to figure out how I got it instead of spending more time how to live my best life with it. And when I got to that stage, things changed, you know, and I think that's really important to kind of focus on that.
Mm. And do you find that the nature, the caliber of the conversation you have with the rheumatology team, has that changed over the years that you're living with? Are you kind of looking at how, like, that idea of living with the condition, and therefore you're thinking of, all right, actually, this also affects how I am?
I would love to see like a more holistic approach. I mean, I would love to be able to go to my rheumatologist and for there to be a dietitian and maybe occupational therapist or maybe an acupuncturist. I think I would love that kind of holistic approach. I would love that to be something that happens in the future, because everything helps. You know, the food thing really helped me with energy in the beginning, definitely. You know, that was a huge thing because I had very little energy and that really helped what I was eating and stuff. I don't really drink anymore. I do find that helps as well.
Definitely,
just all those kind of things, you know. Yeah, like the thought of having a really bad hangover, I don't think I could handle it.
Yeah.
No, definitely not.
You know, I had plenty back in the day, so I'm fine. I'm over it.
Yeah. What about you, Sean? I mean, say there's an area like podiatry, is that part of a multidisciplinary team that would benefit you as well with someone at PSA, do you think?
Thankfully, I haven't had to go that far. Only swelling and it's kind of got down, but yeah, I guess it will be something I will have to explore. But yeah, my rheumatologist is very much into the whole nutrition and exercise side of it as well. He's very much the holistic. It's not just about the medication. It's, you need to look after yourself as well as take your medication. So like, keep your weight off, kind of eat healthy, cut down the alcohol, cut down sugar, and then exercise. Is that if you can get that right, it will help the overall picture. And it is right. Like, I had a very good diet anyway, but I've kind of made some minor tweaks to it, and I would say they definitely have helped.
I wonder, is there one thing that you could identify that you could say, right, where you are now, kind of in the early stages of living with PSA, if I had this piece of information, or this is the one thing that would help me most in managing this condition, what might that be?
I guess knowing when, I guess, to switch to a biologic drug, like, would be great. Mm. Like, what, like, how severe do I have to get? Am I better off going and getting as a preventative measure, or do I wait till my symptoms get? So yeah, that would be the one thing I would, is when to get change my medication and get it right, and with a view to preventing it getting worse in the future.
Mm. And is that something that kind of like either the kind of the variability of symptoms, or even framing it in a positive way, looking at it potentially with regard to remission, say, are they conversations that you have with the rheumatologist?
Yeah, we've definitely spoken about potentially not quite going into remission, but getting it fully under control, that your flare ups are, I guess, few and far between. Definitely would be where I'd love to get to.
Mm.
Like, I'm not bad at the moment, but I'd love to be able to kind of guarantee kind of going into the future that's the way it will be. So get on to a drug that will very much, I will be living with the condition, with just acknowledging that there may be one or two flare-ups in the year, but that's where I would love to get to, being able to live a normal life.
Yeah. What about you, Sinéad, looking back in terms of one piece of information or one thing that would have helped you most back then?
Well, just interesting that you were saying about remission, because they won't use the word remission. No. They just say, look, you're never actually in remission, but you're under control. So I think that's kind of funny. Right. It's obviously just an omerta on the word remission. One piece of advice.
Or something that would have helped you most, you know, in those first, say, two
years. I wish I had switched rheumatologist earlier, because I saw him every single week for 6 months, and every single week I came out feeling like so much worse. Like, I'd become upset after every single. He just never gave me any reassurance. And then I remember eventually one day he goes, oh, like, you will be okay. Like, we'll get this under control. I probably should have mentioned that. I'm like, Jesus. Yes, you should have 5 months ago. So I think getting the right people around you, I think it's really important, because it is a long-term relationship. I now enjoy going to see my rheumatologist. You know, it's not, I don't dread it. I see him, thankfully things are going well, so I see him very rarely, and but I do think it makes a big difference to have somebody who is empathetic and obviously very good at their job as well.
I wonder, you mentioned earlier, Sinéad, about the future and concerns for the future. Looking ahead, how do you see your future with arthritis?
I don't think about it anymore. You know, that's the beauty of where I am now, because it consumed me. I mean, it consumed my every waking moment for probably 2 years. And now I don't really think about it. My phone beeps and I go, it's injection day, and I go, grand, I inject myself, and then I don't think about it. And that's where I wanted to get, and that's where I am, and it is a beautiful thing. Yeah. So I don't think about it, and I don't think about the future, because there's no point. I can't control it. So I just am enjoying every day that I feel so good.
Yeah. How about you, Sean?
Yeah, I guess I'd love to get to that stage as well. Where,
yeah, you will.
Where I guess you're not worrying, you're living, and you just get a gentle reminder, oh, take your medication. But yeah, do I worry about the future? Probably, because I'm in an earlier stage, probably a little bit. But I guess at the moment, I consider I have it pretty much under control. So I'm kind of going, if I can get it under control in the early stages, hopefully it won't develop too bad and I can keep it under control. So I'm generally fairly positive. So I'm trying not to worry too much about the future. I think if I can keep healthy and fit, and that will help everything. So if I keep myself well, that it will help the condition.
Yeah, of course. Yeah. And I mean, keeping it in the day is so important to this, isn't it? You know, that kind of, even all the kind of things about mindfulness and everything else, that the danger of your thoughts running away with you and imagining worst case scenarios, they would just, oftentimes they're just your thoughts, nothing more. They're not reality.
And Googling can be very dangerous, because you're often getting the worst case scenarios. So now I only allow myself Google the Mayo Clinic. That's the only Dr. Google I'm allowed to do from now on. Yeah. But I think Sean's in an amazing space so early on. I mean, you're in a much better place than I was at your stage. So I think it's brilliant.
Exactly. I don't think I quite got as bad as you got in the early days. So that probably has helped.
And you've got a great attitude, which I think is a huge help.
I think it can. If you can get on top of it, it probably won't get on top of you.
Yeah.
Yeah,
if you can try and keep it. I do have bad days sometimes, and especially if you get a flare up or you feel sore, you kind of go, oh no, am I going to be like this for how long this time? And then it might be gone in a couple of days and I'm better again.
Yeah.
So when you have a flare up, it's hard, but you just have to kind of remember, okay, it's a flare up, I'll get out of it.
Yeah, well, I think that line, if you can get on top of it, it won't get on top of you. That's a really positive note on which to draw our conversation to a conclusion. So our sincere thanks to Sinéad Moriarty and Sean Lacey for being with us today. And indeed, thank you too for listening to this first series of Inflammation Nation. On behalf of Gráinne and myself as presenters, I want to pay our thanks to all of our guests and the people who spoke to us over the course of the past 8 weeks. Thanks as well to our own team who are involved in putting the series together, to Peter Boyd, Stephen Lee and Niamh Hogan. Further information about arthritis is available on our website, arthritisireland.ie, via the online support group, which is on Facebook, and via our helpline, which is 0818 252 846. See you next time. Inflammation Nation is supported by Pfizer.